ॐ नमः श्री यतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे. Honorable President of the Chamber of Commerce, Honorable Secretary General, Honorable Vice President, other members and the office bearers of Bharat Chamber of Commerce, dignitaries present here, and my very dear young friends. Mr. Aikat nicely told to keep you smiling. I remember Swami Vivekananda said, by being pleasant always and by being smiling always takes you nearer to God than any other prayer in the world. By being pleasant always and by smiling always takes you nearer to God than any other prayer in the world. So very nicely the President told to keep smiling. That is the main message of Swami Vivekananda. But how to keep smiling? For that we must know the management technique. How to keep smiling under the present scenario, so many problems. Say, anybody you ask, how are you? Fine. But when you go nearby and ask any problem, oh my God, so many problems, if you put into the computer, it will be falling short. The memory is not there. So many problems. So, at the outset, I would like to congratulate the Bharat Chamber of Commerce, number one, that for its existence. I was given a very nice book that has been brought out, and I was going through. The first president was made in the year 1900, that is past century. So an institution surviving for 112 years itself is the biggest tribute to that institution. Surviving. Many institutions come forward. They come into existence after 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, maximum 10 years, they're gone. But here is Bharat Chamber of Commerce still existing. So I have to give congratulations on three counts. Number one, for its existence. Number two, not only that it is existing, it is live. Many institutions are there existing for more than 100 years, but they are living on oxygen. But here is a live institution. I was going through, so many programs are being conducted and keeping in touch with the latest technologies, latest developments in various fields, whether political, economical, or in the managerial field. So on the second count, I have to give congratulations for keeping it not exist, but keeping it alive. And thirdly, I would like to congratulate the Chamber of Commerce for taking the initiative, becoming a pioneer institution of its sort to celebrate Swami Vivekananda's 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda. You know, Swami Vivekananda's 150th birth anniversary is being celebrated all over the world, not only in India. We wanted this to be celebrated in 2013-14 because 12 January 1863, Swami Vivekananda was born, and only after 100 years makes it 12 January 2013. So from 2013 to 14, we wanted to celebrate. And we approached the Government of India. The Government of India has constituted a central committee with the Honorable Prime Minister as the chairperson, and with 9 chief ministers of various states, 3 monks of Ramakrishna order, and 65 other renowned persons from the country. We wanted from 2013 to 14, but they said, why not start from now itself? So the celebration is taking place from 2010 to 14. 4 years it is going on. In fact, last year, in the month of October, UNESCO had a special exhibition at the Paris Town Hall. And as you know, recently in Chicago University, a Vivekananda chair has been started by the Government of India, has donated $1.5 million to start Vivekananda chair. So not only in India, all over the world, the celebration is taking place. Many institutions have come forward to celebrate the event in a befitting manner. including some Rotaries, Lions. We had a special meeting called by the Chief Minister of Gujarat on 12 December when he called 150 enlightened citizens of the whole of state to discuss as to how this whole year should be celebrated. And there were so many suggestions, and many Rotary clubs, many Chamber of Commerce, they have given their suggestions, and they said that they themselves will be celebrating in a befitting manner. But they are planning. But here the Bharat Chamber of Commerce has executed the plan, and as today it is a lecture on Swami Vivekananda. That is why I must congratulate. Another thing is that the topic that has been kept, I must congratulate for that also, because Swami Vivekananda's personality was a multifaceted personality. Just now we had a very beautiful welcome address from the President, Mr. Aikat. What a wonderful address. And so many points have already been covered and has been told rightly that Swami Vivekananda's personality was a multifaceted personality, and particularly his this dimension, that he of course was a great saint of a highest order. He was a great Vedantin. Many people say that no, he was a great patriot who inspired the patriots like Mahatma Gandhi, Subhash Chandra Bose, Dr. Radhakrishnan, Jawaharlal Nehru, Chakravarti, Rajagopalachari, Sri Aurobindo, etc. So he was a great patriot. He was a great writer, a great orator who made 7,000 people stand in awe just when he uttered Sisters and Brothers of America in the World Parliament of Religions, Chicago, on 11 September 1893. Mind you, that was also 9/11. But we didn't listen to the message of Swami Vivekananda of Harmony of Religions. But there was another 9/11 in 2001. But that is because we did not listen to the message of Swami Vivekananda. But whatever it is, some people take Swami Vivekananda to be a great orator, a great writer, a great patriot, a great journalist who started many journals and who inspired many people to start various journals during his lifetime, and after his lifetime it continued. It's a multifaceted personality. But one dimension that has not yet been very much projected is that he was a leader of the supreme type. Today when we are talking about globalization, the only one global leader who is being accepted to the all the countries, to all the creeds, to all the religions, people of all folds, is a global leader. We are talking about globalization. Where is global peace? Global peace cannot come unless until there is a global civilization. And global civilization cannot come till we have global leaders to inspire that global perspective on religions and on all various facets. And what a wonderful thing that Swami Vivekananda talked about globalization more than 100 years back. And he is a global leader who is acceptable to various countries and to the people of various faiths. And Swami Vivekananda in his lifetime had friends of all castes, of belonging to various creeds, various religions, and various countries. In fact, when United States brought out the great 100 people who built New America, one of the names was Swami Vivekananda in America. In India, we have still to prepare that. We are babe. In fact, they said that Swami Vivekananda is our discovery, because when he was wandering throughout the country in India, you were not giving him bread also. Sometimes he had to go begging, and sometimes he would not get bread. But when he came to America and when he became world famous, now you are giving so much of respect. So it is, America says it's our own. Swami Vivekananda is our own. India says no, basically he's from our India. So many countries are claiming Swami Vivekananda. There is a beautiful book by Elinor Stark, and she has written the book. The name of the book is The Gift Unopened. The Gift Unopened, where she says all the problems of America today is that Swami Vivekananda gave the best gift when he came here in the form of the nectar of Vedanta. But that gift has remained unopened. And when we rediscover that gift, all our problems, stress management, everything will be there. All the stress will be removed. All our problems will be removed. And she has given a very beautiful statement that Columbus discovered the soil of America, but Vivekananda discovered the soul of America. Vivekananda discovered the soul of America. And that is why America says we have a claim on Vivekananda. Vivekananda gave his best in America. In fact, the first center of the Ramakrishna Mission was started in New York in 1896. In 1897, Swami Vivekananda started Ramakrishna Mission. Before that, in America, he had already started a center in New York, which is still existing. I went last year. I stayed there in that center. Of course, the building has been changed, but same Vedanta Society in New York. He started in 1896. At that time, he had a global perspective, way back in 1896. In 1993 event, he said, we will have to make a claim there. So Swami Vivekananda discovered the soul of America. America gives a claim. India has got a claim on Vivekananda. And of all types of people used to meet Swami Vivekananda. So he's a global leader with a global perspective. Today when we are talking about globalization, where is the global leader who would be acceptable to various creeds and various religions? And that is why he became popular, that in Chicago Parliament of Religions, Swami Vivekananda said, we do not only tolerate all religions, but we accept all religions as equally true. For the first time, a person has claimed that all religions lead to the same goal, because he had seen his guru, Sri Ramakrishna, practicing Islam, Christianity, Hinduism by turn. So, and he said, the life of my guru was a laboratory of parliament of religions, was itself a parliament of religions, where he practiced all religions and said, Joto Mot, Toto Pot. As many faiths, so many paths, and that is based on this Swami Vivekananda had said, and that is why he gave in to the parliament religious. And he had friends from all, Miss McLeod, Mrs. Olibool, so many of American friends, they were all Christians, they became his friends. So many Christian fathers became his friends. And in England when he went, again, Miss Margaret Noble became his disciple, and later on, she sacrificed her whole life. And then she came to India to start the first school for girls. That time only 1% girls were literate. And Swami Vivekananda said, without the women development, India's development cannot take place. No nation can progress without the development of its women. A bird cannot fly only in one wing. So without the women development, a nation cannot develop. And women development can take place only when women are educated. And so he wanted in 1897, when he came back to India, the first thing he wanted was to start an institution for teaching the girls, and Calcutta at that time was the capital of British India, and that is why he wanted to start the school here, but he could not get one person who would take up his ideas, and so he gave a clarion call to Miss Margaret Noble of England, who gave up her whole life and dedicated her whole life for the sake of educating Indian women. That is why when Swami Vivekananda gave her the Brahmacharya Diksha, he gave her the name Nivedita, the dedicated one. And that is why Rabindranath Tagore used to call her Lok Mata Nivedita. That Nivedita worked here. Now you see Nivedita Girls School is still there in Calcutta. But Swami Vivekananda had that vision at that time. So he had Christian, he had Muslims. When Swami Vivekananda was here wandering, he became a friend of Mohammad Sarfaraz Hussain of Nainital. And in fact, he wrote a letter. I quoted that letter to Dr. Kalam when he became the president, because he has got a good friendship with us. So I wrote him a letter that Swami Vivekananda wrote to Mohammad Sarfaraz Hussain in that time, to of Nainital, that I see in my mental eye, in vision, a new India arising with a Vedantic brain and Islamic body. Both together will give us the great India. Swami Vivekananda prophesied that at that time. This Mohammad Sarfaraz Hussain later on became Swami Mohammadananda. And he wrote articles in Prabuddha Bharata. You see these articles. So Swami Vivekananda had friends from various communities across the countries, various religions of various tratas, poor, rich. Many kings became his friends, his disciples. The Maharaja of Khetri, the Maharaja of Porbandar, the Maharaja of Baroda, the Maharaja of Bhuj, so many Maharaja of Mysore. In fact, the letter that was quoted by Mr. Aikath was that letter, beautiful letter Swami Vivekananda wrote to Maharaja of Mysore. My dear prince, this life is short. The vanities of this world are transient. In this short life, they alone live, who live for others. The rest are more dead than alive. This is what Swami Vivekananda wrote to Maharaj of Mysore. So Swami Vivekananda had friends in Maharaj. So many princes were his friends. At the same time, Swami Vivekananda said, I am no philosopher, no metaphysician, no saint. I am poor. I love the poor. He had poor friends. He had rich friends. He could stay with a beggar. He could stay with a king. He was having a multifaceted personality who was acceptable to all. Today what we need when we are talking about globalization is a global personality with a global perspective. And who could be a better role model for that global personality than Swami Vivekananda? And in his name, when we are having 150th birth anniversary, I congratulate the Bharat Chamber of Commerce to take the initiative of having another dimension of Swami Vivekananda which is not known. That is his leadership qualities, his managerial excellence, that the vision that he had at that time, the global perspective that he had. Many people are unaware about this, his management. In fact, I was very much surprised to find this very much a good comment from Mr. M.V. Kamath, the ex-editor of Illustrated Weekly. He says, when I started reading Swami Vivekananda, I must admit that frankly, I did not expect all these revolutionary thoughts coming from him. But as far as back as the turn of the century, Swami Vivekananda was talking like a management guru of the late 21st century. This is what M.V. Kamath has to say. So this particular aspect of Swami Vivekananda, his leadership qualities, his wisdom of the management expert is not available. Now, at the outset, I must say, when we are talking about vision of Swami Vivekananda, the great innovator of management values, we must know that when Swami Vivekananda left his body, the management science that we know was not yet evolved. It was in the stage of evolution. Taylor had not yet made the work measurement techniques. And after the First World War, the scientific management that we now talk about was evolved. So when Swami Vivekananda was there, there was no such management or management books or no such management. But in fact, management is nothing but organized common sense, and that is from time immemorial. But what management we know, the science of management, that particular started only after the First World War. And it started only, the management technique started first of all with managing the armies, and later on it went into the organized labor force. It started with work measurement, then work study, and then production, then productivity, and then other departments came up. But Peter Drucker says in his book, The Best of Peter Drucker has come up. You know, Peter Drucker died year before last. He was a very much acclaimed management guru of America. All his books, the best books, have been condensed into one beautiful book, The Best of Peter Drucker, where he says that we made a mistake, I do not know from why and where, from 1930, we started making a mistake that equating management with only business management. But business management is only one part of the management. It is like telling pediatrics. Pediatrics is only a part of medicine. Medicine has got so many dimensions. So, but whatever it is, this management that we know has evolved later on, after the departure of Swami Vivekananda. As you know, on 4 July 1902, Swami Vivekananda gave up his body. And this came up later on. But whatever management techniques that we know, Swami Vivekananda unconsciously practiced them. Not only that, whatever techniques we are now talking about was practiced by Swami Vivekananda in his own life. So I'll give only a few, two or three examples only. There are so many examples that could be given. For example, we are talking about now values. Value-based management has become an in-subject. There is a beautiful book, The Power of Ethical Management by Kenneth Blanchard and Norman Vincent Peale, where it is written on the front page, that book, The Power of Ethical Management, you need not cheat in order to win. You need not cheat in order to win. And one of the paragraphs starts with this. To work only for profit is like playing tennis with your eyes on the scoreboard rather than on the ball. To work only for profit is like playing tennis with your eyes on the scoreboard rather than on the ball. So what we have to give emphasis is on values, not only profit, but the way in which we are making that profit. So the value has become very important, but Swami Vivekananda talked about it 100 years back. He said, if you really want to succeed, you must have credibility. Credibility will come when you practice values. And this is what we are now seeing today. Because of the globalization, which are the companies surviving? The companies having credibility, who believe in quality, who believe in TQM, who believe in zero defect, who believe in quality, at the same time who believe in delivery schedule, and who believe in giving the product at the most competitive price, who believe in productivity. Others are getting wiped out. Why? Because on a long run, they practice values. The values of credibility, the values of delivery schedule, the values of quality. Those companies survive. When there was a great, even now, recession is going on in a big way. In India, we have slightly come out of that recession, that which was there 2 years back. But in America, I saw it is there in a big way. And America is in a mess. I do not know what will happen. I saw very good, nice people begging in the street. I saw with my own eyes. Not all of them, some. But this trend has started. The photograph that was shown for Russia a few years back, same I saw with my own eyes. One person came back from, he was crossing a street. Suddenly he came back. He came back, I thought he might have forgotten something. But he opened the lid of a box, waste box. And waste box he opened, I thought he might have forgotten and he might have put something. But what he did, he took out a half bottle of some Coca-Cola or something, drink, and a half a loaf of bread was there and started eating. And he was looking like a big gentleman, like a CEO of a company from the dress. But he did like this on before my eyes. That was in San Francisco. So various parts, I saw ladies with a board that I have to feed children, please give me. So that recession has come. We have come out of our recession in India more or less. But in America, it is still there. But in that recession, which are the companies who have survived? Those who have practiced values. The rest have been wiped out. So what Swami Vivekananda said about values is very, very important. Azim Premji was interviewed by India Today. What is the secret of your success? He said, I believe in practicing values. And then he said, I believe that the principle of trusteeship management is very relevant today. If you want to have success, any multinational company want to have success, you must practice trusteeship management, which was popularized by Mahatma Gandhi. But though it was popularized by Mahatma Gandhi, it was practiced also, many people do not know that it was first introduced into the corporate sector by Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda, when he went in 1893 to participate in the World Pal of Religion, at that time, the richest person of the world was John D. Rockefeller, the emperor of petroleum industry. And John D. Rockefeller at that time was undergoing a very, very critical phase of his life. He was very much in very much morose, very much depressed. All his hair had gone and he was contemplating suicide. So much depressed he was. And when one of his friends came to know about it, that he was contemplating suicide, he said, you know, in one of my friend's house, an Indian monk has come. And I think you should meet him and get his advice. And I think you will be able to overcome depression. Rockefeller said, what? I to go to a beggar for getting advice? You know, we are all beggars. We are all professional beggars. We live on charity, on donations. We do not earn. So we are all beggars. He said, what? I to go to a beggar for getting advice? No, I will not go. And he did not go. One fine morning, suddenly he came to the place where Swamiji was residing. He called the bell, the butler opened the door. Now, he entered inside without being announced, and Swamiji at that time was not in the drawing room, he was in his study room. Without being announced, he entered the study room. Swamiji was fully engrossed. You know, Swami Vivekananda had great power of concentration. When he would do something, one at a time, he was oblivious of the whole surroundings. So he was fully engrossed in his study. Rockefeller stood for some time and then knocked at the table. And then Swami Vivekananda looked up. Rockefeller said, I am Rockefeller. Swami Vivekananda said, what do you want? Now, Rockefeller was not prepared for this type of treatment. Rockefeller means the president of America would get up on his seat. And here he is sitting and asking, what do you want? He was very much annoyed. He said, I don't want anything. Then Swami said, then why have you come? Now he had no answer because he had come without invitation. Then Swami Vivekananda said, Rockefeller, I know why you have come. You have come here because you do not have peace of mind. And then Swami Vivekananda started narrating many incidents from the life of Swami Vivekananda which no one else knew except Rockefeller. And he became very much terrified. All his secrets are out. Who told all these things to you? How did you come to know? Swami Vivekananda said, do you think it is necessary somebody should tell me? I can see through your mind as I can see through a glass almirah. Then Rockefeller was very much terrified. My God, he has come to know all my secrets. Then Swami Vivekananda said, my dear Rockefeller, remember, you are not the owner of your wealth. All the wealth that you are having has been given to you by God. Remember, you are only a custodian of your wealth. You are not the owner of your wealth. Utilize this money for removing the sufferings of millions of people. Immediately you will get peace of mind. There is no other way by which you can get peace of mind. Rockefeller was not prepared to listen to anybody's advice, least of all from a beggar like Swami Vivekananda. So he became very much annoyed and just left abruptly, as abruptly he had come. He disappeared. But after a few days, again he came. Again he called the bell. The butler opened the door. He again went inside. Swamiji was not in the drawing room. Again he went to his study room without being announced. Swamiji was fully engrossed. Again he knocked at the table. Then Swamiji looked up. And then Rockefeller put a piece of paper in which he had made an announcement of a very huge donation for a public cause. Swami Vivekananda read that paper and then Rockefeller said, now you must thank me. I followed your advice. Swamiji said, well, it is for you to thank me. Because by following my advice, you will get peace of mind which cannot be purchased by millions of dollars in the market. That was the first huge donation of Rockefeller. Later on, Rockefeller made Rockefeller Foundation, as you know. And from that Rockefeller Foundation, Nobel Prize winning researchers have been done. What a great work. And then Rockefeller, he not only that he committed suicide, not that he was saved from suicide, he went on living for very, very long, many years, nearing about 100 years. And then at the fag end of his life, he wrote his autobiography. Autobiography, he wrote that this life is not meant only for earning money. There is more to earning, and the life is meant for serving others. And the greatest satisfaction is obtained by serving others. He has not given the name of Swami Vivekananda there, but at least he has written all the thoughts of Swami Vivekananda. Whatever Swami Vivekananda said, he has given there. And I was surprised when I got the news. Somewhere I read in an article that when Bill Gates came for the first time to India, first visit, he came to Calcutta first, then he went to other places many years back. That time, there was an interview by some newspapers, and they asked, why have you come? He said, I have got a great regard for the culture heritage of India. And he said, but how did you get that? He said, by reading the books of Swami Vivekananda. Have you read any book on Swami Vivekananda? He said, I do not go to bed without reading a few pages from the books of Swami Vivekananda. And the Karma Yoga is my favorite book. When I read this, I couldn't believe. Because my concept of Bill Gates, who believes in cutting the throat of others, in cutthroat competition, how could he be reading the books of Swami? I am talking many years back. But after 2 years, I read in the newspaper that Bill Gates has announced that he will start an institution called Melinda Bill Gates Foundation, and all his money, excepting a few dollars for his three children, he will keep the whole thing, he will keep in a trust, and he will give all for charity. Whole thing goes to charity. And really he gave $30 billion and started Melinda Bill Gates Foundation, and that has already completed 10 years. And every year he has been the greatest donor for various causes. Now I can believe he must have read the books of Swami Vivekananda. But when I went to the website of Bill Gates, I wanted to confirm whether Bill Gates, I do not know how this newspapers, who are the newspaper I was trying to find out. But there, it is told that Bill Gates got the inspiration for charity from David Rockefeller. And David Rockefeller is the youngest child of John D. Rockefeller. So that gets the connection. So John D. Swami Vivekananda inspired John D. Rockefeller. John D. Rockefeller inspired his son David Rockefeller. From David Rockefeller, Bill Gates got the connection. But whatever it is, what we are talking about, corporate responsibility, which has become the need of the hour. It's a very, very hot subject and topic on which we are all discussing. Swami Vivekananda for the first time talked about social responsibility, corporate responsibility. Not only that, the principle of trusteeship management. Though the seeds of trusteeship management are all our scriptures. Ishavashyapanishad says, Ishavasya midam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat tena taktena bhunji tha ma gridakasya siddhanam. The whole world is permeated by one universal consciousness. Ishavasyam idam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat tena. Because the whole world is one, it's a holistic universe, even the modern science has proved it. Bell's theorem states all the particles of the whole universe are interconnected at a deeper level, and that has been verified experimentally by David Bohm, a Nobel Prize physicist. And that is why another Nobel Prize physicist, Schrodinger, says consciousness is a singular of which the plural is unknown. So that same universal consciousness, it is one world, it's a holistic universe. The whole world is permeated by one universal consciousness. Isha vasyam idam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat sarvam kalu idam brahma. So yatkincha jagatyam. So what happens? Tena taktena punjitha. Therefore, enjoy the world by renunciation. How can I enjoy the world? By giving up my all the items. By renunciation, how can I enjoy? No, you need not renounce. You need not give up your Mercedes-Benz car or your latest model mobile or your latest model dress or latest your house that you have built. No. What you have to renounce? Tena taktena bhunjitha. Enjoy. Enjoy the world by renunciation. What you have to give up is not your car or not your mobile or not your house. What you have to give up? Tena taktena bhunjitha. Ma gridaka kasyachidhanam. Do not covet others' wealth, and what you have to give up is your proprietorship, your attachment, your sense of attachment, your selfishness. It is this which is causing sorrow. Today, if all over the world, so many rich people, they are all suffering in spite of the wealth, is because of this. They are not able to give up the attachment to their wealth. They are not able to make charity to others. They are having a lot of money, but they are getting suffocated because they are not having a free flow of that economy. The more you, Swami Vivekananda says, the more you give, the more will come back to you. Swami Vivekananda says, unselfishness is more paying in the long run. Unfortunately, people do not have the patience to practice it. And he says, you vacate the air out of this room, fresh air will come automatically. Once you start giving charity, more will come to you. More will come to you. I remember a very good joke. An unemployed graduate, you know, unemployment is one of the features of our modern management. I went to a father, Christian father. Father, this is too much. I'm not getting employment. I'm suffering. He said, you see, you should pray to God. I am praying to God, but God is not listening to my prayer. I am praying to God for giving me a job, but he's not listening. I said, then father said, you know, try to make the prayer more effective. How can I make the prayer more effective? Then he said, make it more holistic. If the more holistic the prayer, more unselfish the prayer, the quicker is the result. So try to make it a little more holistic, little more unselfish. What is the example? Example is like this. For example, if you tell God, if you give me the job, 10% I will give for charity. That makes it holistic. You are not talking, you are not only your welfare, I will give 10% of charity for others. That makes it a holistic prayer. Okay, I don't mind. I have nothing, 0% income. If I get some income, 10%, I don't mind. And he started praying, "Oh Lord, if you give me a job, whatever money I get, 10% I give for charity, sure." He gave the promise. And after 1 week came to the running, "Father, it has worked. The holistic prayer has worked. And I have got a job of $100. So this is $10, Father, please, for charity." Then after a few weeks, he came, "Father, I am getting $1,000. So here is $100. Then $10,000 he started getting. So he said, $1,000. Then when he started getting $50,000, "Father, this is too much. $5,000 I have to give for charity is a very big figure. Is there no other way out by which I can come out of it?" Father was very intelligent. He said, "You see, my son, you know, you cannot take back the words that you have given, promise that you have given to God. There is no such, you know, such system existing. But I can give you one thing. You tell God to reduce your salary so that you can have affordable donation." "That you can give. But 10% you cannot reduce now. That you can reduce. You can tell your God to reduce your salary so that it is an affordable donation." Whatever it is, this unselfishness, this giving back to the society, this is a must. If we want happiness and peace, we must have at least 10%, 5%, 1%. You decide your own percentage. Some percentage of your income should go to charity. But try to see that it goes to the proper place. That is very important. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, "Bhakto hobi to hobi, boka hobi kano." Don't be a fool. Be practical. So you give charity, or many corporate sectors are having now their own trust and their own NGOs. It's okay. Whatever it is, you try to see that the donation, that the charity goes to the proper person. Try to utilize it. But if it goes to the real proper recipients, you will get the blessings of those poor people. Blessings of the Lord who is present on those pure people. The blessings of the Lord will be there and you will get immediate peace of mind. So this trusteeship management, that is the concept of, that may be popularized by others, but for the first time in the corporate sector, Swami Vivekananda introduced it, and now we are talking about corporate responsibility. Another thing now in America, and of course in the whole world, one more a term is becoming very popular, and that is called servant leadership. John Greenleaf, he started this concept in 1970 in America. But now it is catching up, and all over the world now they're talking about servant leadership. But what is servant leadership? Servant leadership is not taking the credit to yourself as a leader. You inspire your colleagues, you inspire your subordinates by your example, not by preaching, but by your own example. And don't dictate them. Just share your ideas with them, inspire them, not order them, but inspire them. Hire and fire method will not work. There's a beautiful book by Peter Drucker, Managing in the Next Millennium, where he says, managers and executives are going to be more and more ineffectual with no authority whatsoever over their subordinates in the 21st century. Managers and executives from now onwards are going to be more and more ineffectual with no authority whatsoever their subordinates. You can see for yourself, you are also experiencing this, that no more you can demand that type of obedience from your subordinates. Why? He says, because it's going to be a knowledge society. The 21st century is going to be a century of knowledge society. Previously, what you were working with, the people with whom you were working, were having all blue-collar jobs, very few white-collar jobs. Now, reverse thing has happened. Most of them are white-collar jobs. The blue-collar jobs is being done by computers. And some of them are computer experts, IT professionals. How do you control them? Who are having more IQ than you? Who are having better IQ than you? How do you control them? You will not be able to control them through power and position and through order, but you can control them through love, through the attitude of service, through the attitude of sharing your power with them. That is the new concept of management that is coming. Swami Vivekananda practiced this servant leadership more than 100 years back. He practiced it. What did he do? When he started Ramakrishna Mission, he started mission not in his name, in the name of his guru, Sri Ramakrishna. For, and why did he start it? For giving a practical demonstration of the message that was given by Sri Ramakrishna. That is, Shiva Gyane Jeeva Seva. Sri Ramakrishna said, Lord is present everywhere, in the churches, in the mosques, in the temples. But the greatest Lord is present in each and every human being. That is why Swami Vivekananda wrote to his Guru Bhais, beautiful letter. He said, so far you had heard the mantras. What are the mantras you had heard? Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava, Atithi Devo Bhava. I am giving you some additional mantras which are more important for the modern age. What are those mantras? Daridra Devo Bhava, Rogi Devo Bhava. Worship the Lord who is present in the poor people. Worship the Lord who is present in the sick people. That is why in our hospitals, we don't call them hospitals. These are all our Seva Pratishtan. Biggest hospital is just nearby, Shishu Mangal. Now it is called Seva Pratishtan. It is an experiment on serving the God in human form. So in Benares, we call it Narayan Bhandar. Narayan Bhandar is the Bhandar from where the food is given to the patients. And the monks take the prasad of this Rogi Narayana. From Narayan Bhandara, first of all, the patients have been given the food. Whatever is remaining, that is taken by the monks. Because they are all Narayana, we have to take prasad. So these are all Rogi Narayana, Daridra Narayana. We are not doing social service. We are trying to worship the God who is present in the temple, in the church, in the mosque. The same God is present in the poor people, in the sick people. So all the time we are worshipping God. So Swami Vivekananda gave that new mandate. Work is worship. Not just by false imagination of work is worship. No. He did not equate it that you just pray to Lord and then you offer your fruits to the Lord. That is Gita way of worship, converting work into worship. But Swami Vivekananda gave a new holistic way of converting work into worship. Why? He said, the same Lord is present everywhere. It is the one universal consciousness present everywhere, inside every human being. And so what happens? If one and many be the same reality, it is not only all modes of work, all modes of worship, but all modes of work also become worship. So Nivedita, Sister Nivedita, gave a beautiful introduction to the complete works of Swami Vivekananda, 9 volumes. She says in the introduction, this is the realization which makes Vivekananda the great preacher of karma, not as diverse from, but as expressing jnana and bhakti. To him the workshop, the farmyard, the laboratory are as true and fit scenes for meeting God with man as the door of a temple or the cell of a monk. So whole thing becomes a holistic thing. The whole thing becomes a very, very sacred thing. No difference henceforth between sacred and secular, Nivedita says. No difference henceforth between sacred and secular. Everything is sacred. To work is to worship. To labor is to pray. And to renounce is to conquer. No difference between sacred and secular. This sacred and secular symbiosis, that is the greatest gift of Swami Vivekananda to the modern age. He says, this is the message of practical Vedanta. By application of this Vedanta, a fisherman will become a better fisherman, a manager will become a better manager, an executive will become a better executive. Wherever you are, by the application of this Vedanta, you develop that supra-efficiency. They are talking about zero defect, TQM. Bhagavad Gita, it is already told, buddhi yukta jahatiha ubhe sukrit duskrite tasmat yoga yujasva yoga karmasu kaushalam. What is yoga? Dexterity in action, efficiency in action, 100% efficiency, 0% defect. That is how work is getting converted into worship. Work can be converted to worship with full concentration, with 100% efficiency. That makes the work worship. But most important is the attitude. I am not working. No, what I am doing is worshipping the Lord who is present in the form of a poor person. So this experiment was done, Swami Vivekananda had a vision, but he was not only visionary, he was a visionary, but he was also a missionary. Two in one, visionary and missionary. He had a great vision. He wrote to Miss Mary Hell, beautiful letter, Miss Mary Hell. He wrote a beautiful letter in the month of June from Almora. And there he's, if you read that letter, you get the whole mission and vision of Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda writes, Mary, I had to talk a lot about myself because I owed that to you. Now I feel my task is done. At the most, 3 or 4 years of left life are left behind. You know, he's writing in 1897 and 1902 he passed away. Before 5 years he's writing, at the most, 3 or 4 years of left life are left behind. I never wanted earthly enjoyments. I have lost all wish for my salvation. I must see my machine in strong working order. And knowing for certain that I have put in a lever for the good of humanity, which no power can yet drive back, at least in India, I will sleep without caring what will be next. And may I be born again and again and suffer thousands of miseries so that I may worship the only God that exists, the only God that I believe in, the sum total of all souls, and above all, my God the wicked, my God the miserable, my God the poor of all races of all species is the special object of my worship. It is for worshipping that God present in wicked. We are going to the prison houses and we are telling, you are also God. Atman is there inside each and every human being. Only covering has come. Somewhere the covering is thin. If you have done 7 murders, covering is thick. If you have done 14 murders, the covering is still thicker, but it is a covering. Atman is never, never spoiled by any amount of work. That is always splendorous. That is what Swami Vivekananda told in the Parliament of Religions. Ye children of immortal bliss, holy and perfect beings, ye divinities on earth, sinners, it is a sin to call a man so. It is a standing liable on human nature. Come up, O lions, and shake up the delusion that you are sheep. Your souls immortal, spirits free, blessed and eternal. Ye are not matter, ye are not bodies. Matter is a servant, not he the servant of matter. It is for this worship of the God in human beings that Swami Vivekananda started Shiva Gyane Jiva Seva. He started Ramakrishna Mission. And as I told you, when a person starts an institution, when he dies, the institution gets closed after a few days or few years. But Swami Vivekananda passed away on 4 July 1902. There was one center in New York, 5 centers there were in India, total 6 centers. And today, after the passing of Swami Vivekananda, after 110 years, there are 174 branch centers all over the world, 40 abroad, rest in India, and 1,000 non-affiliated centers with 14 indoor hospitals, 90 outdoor dispensaries, 60 mobile dispensaries, removing the sufferings of approximately 1 crore of patients free of cost. These medicines are given, treatment is given free of cost, minimum 1 crore people per year. 6,000 educational institutions where 6 lakh students are being given value education along with the proper education. And they are all, you know, the results of Ramakrishna Mission schools, colleges, not only top in academic brilliance, but also in character building. Some of the best people have been given by our institutions, and rural and tribal development projects. So many rural and tribal development projects. And whenever there is a disaster, the first day Ramakrishna Mission is there. Everybody knows. We do not wait for any call from the government or even from the public. And not only that, even the public says no, still we do the work. Yes, this has really happened. One of the villages when I was in Porbandar, I'm now in 6 years, from 6 years, you know, we also get transferred. So we have 174 centers. From 6 years, I'm in Baroda. 8 years, I was in Porbandar. Before that, 10 years, I was in Rajkot, editing Gujarati Monthly. Before that, 10 years, I was in Ranchi, one of the best Krishi Vigyan Kendras of the country, a big tribal development project. I was there for 10 years. Likewise, we get transferred. So when I was in Porbandar, there was, you know, on 26 January 2001, there was the earthquake. And we came to know that one of the villages nearby, all the houses have collapsed. And so we went there and started a kitchen. Now, those who were from the higher caste, he said, you give us all the items, we will take care of your relief work. He said, no, we want to worship God with our own eyes, with our own hands. So we will be doing ours. No, no, you give the food and you go away. That means they wanted to, as they thought, like government people have come and we take away the whole thing. We said, no. Then after a few days, they said, now you must close the kitchen because now we are well up. But we came to know that some of the poor Harijans were still starving and they had not yet got the job because there was so much of problem all around. We said, we are going to continue this kitchen as long as even a single person is without food. Then do you know the consequences? Do you know the consequences? That was a gang leader. I came to know that village was the most notorious village, and perhaps that is why all the houses had collapsed. Maybe because law of karma. But we have to do the work where maximum collapse is there. You know, our law of karma is like this. So we wanted to do work there. And this person, they are very notorious gang leader, said, do you know the consequence? I said, I know the consequence. You know, I am a monk. As monks, we first of all do our own Shraddha and then we take the sannyasa. So we are not afraid of death. He was not prepared for this type of reply. And then our kitchen continued. Later on, they came to know our activities. And when the colony was built, afterwards we had our kitchen, we had primarily, then we had a big colony. When the colony was, the inauguration day, the same gang leader came, Swamiji, you have constructed the houses, you have constructed the community hall, you have constructed temple, everything is okay. But today, whole village will be fed by us. And so we will contribute, all the villagers we will have, now we will feed you. And there will be community dinner. This is how the transformation took place. Whatever it is, but this disaster management and everything, all these activities are going on after the passing away of Swami Vivekananda. So just now, Mr. Aikath had very nicely quoted Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda said, before, he said this to Mr. Eric Hammond when he was in England. It may be that I shall find it good to get outside of this body, to cast it off like a disused garment, but I shall not cease to work. I shall inspire men everywhere until the world shall know that it is one with God. And so Swamiji is still surviving in the fine form, and that is why perhaps he has inspired you to have this program today here. And so Swami Vivekananda was, he practiced servant leadership, and he started Ramakrishna Mission not in his own name, in the name of his guru. But he himself did not become the first president. You know, what is servant leadership? What is nobility of leadership? Mahatma Gandhi also practiced servant leadership. When Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam had come to inaugurate one of the 81 school buildings we had constructed as a part of earthquake rehabilitation, that was on 13 February 2002, he had come to Porbandar. And that time he gave a very inspiring speech to 3,000 youths, and then they asked, what is the source of inspiration? Then Dr. Kalam said, normally I do not leak out this secret, but this is the right place to leak out this secret, Porbandar. Then he said, I was in 8th standard, I was a monitor of my school. My headmaster called me, he said, today, tonight, you have to call all the students to the school, let them listen to the running commentary on radio, no TV at that time. 15th August 1947, India will become independent, let them listen to the running commentary. So Dr. Kalam said, I gathered all the students and we listened to the running commentary. We were very happy that India has become independent. But that time we knew only Tamil. We didn't know Hindi or English. So we could not understand the speech, but we were very happy. Then Dr. Kalam said, next day I saw newspapers. I saw a photograph showing Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru hoisting the Indian flag on the Red Fort. And he said, I was so happy to see that flag. Then he said, by the side was another photograph. There's another photograph. And then Dr. Kalam said, that second photograph was my primary education, was my secondary education, was my college education, and was my life education. And what was that photograph? That photograph was showing that when the whole nation was rejoicing because of the independence of India, the one person who made this singularly possible with his own vision and with his own sacrifice, that person was not rejoicing. He was walking barefooted in the streets of Kolkata, wiping the tears of the people who had been suffering because of the Noakhali riots, Mahatma Gandhi. And then he said, I could understand what is the nobility of leadership. He could have become the first Prime Minister of India. For sacrifice, he was first. For getting the fruits, he was the last. That is what Swami Vivekananda says. What is the secret of leadership? He said, this is what is leadership. Sirdar, wahi sardar. Kaun sardar ban sakta hai? Jo sir de sakta hai. One who can sacrifice his ego, one who can sacrifice his selfishness, one who can sacrifice his prejudices, he alone can become a successful leader. So sirdar, wahi sardar. That is servant leadership. That was practiced by Mahatma Gandhi and that was practiced by Swami Vivekananda. When Swamiji was in America, he drafted the trust deed of Ramakrishna Math, which has to be registered in the Belur here registry office, and he made his brother disciple Swami Brahmananda as the first president. He did not become the first. He did not take the power position. For sacrificing, he was ahead. For getting the benefit, he was the last. When he came back from America, whatever little money he could collect through his great work, how much hard he worked, he almost gave the blood of his whole body. Can you imagine? So many lectures, so much of touring within a short span. He spent the whole force. And in fact, when he was giving up his body on 4 July 1902, just 2 days before, he told his disciples, when I die, cremate me here. He showed a spot near the Bellur tree. And really, after 2 days, the body was cremated on the same spot. Now you find the temple of Swami Vivekananda. If you go to Bellur Math, you will find temple of Swami. That is on the spot where Swami Vivekananda's body was cremated. But Swami Vivekananda had predicted. He said, when I die, you cremate me here. That time nobody took seriously because he was only 39 years. But one disciple asked, Swami, why you want to give up your body so quickly, so early? He's only 39 years. Then Swami Vivekananda said, I have done enough for next 1500 years. 1500 years. Whatever I have given the message, it will take 1500 years for us to implement that message. I have done enough for next 1500 years. Swamiji said that he is with us in fine form to work out this message, but he has given a mandate to us that he has done enough for 1500 years. That whole, so much of homework he has given to us. Whatever ideas, even one idea to implement that idea is a big thing. And he put this machinery, not only that he talked theoretically, but he put a machinery to demonstrate this model of whether really worship of God in man can be done. Yes, here is the Ramakrishna Mission. The monks who are supposed to meditate in the Himalayas, the monks who are supposed to only meditate and take the name of the Lord are now going to the slums and wiping the tears of the widowed people, wiping the tears of the afflicted people, educating the poor, educating the masses, educating the women. This is what was never thought of. Swami Vivekananda was a revolutionary monk. He said, monks, he told, give them the mantra. No atmano mokshartham now. He gave a new mantra. Atmano mokshartham jagadhitaya cha. Yes, atmano mokshartham will be there, but not remaining in the cave, not remaining in Himalayas, not going to the forest, living in the society, serving the society, you have to advance further. So that type of, that servant leadership was practically demonstrated by Swami Vivekananda. And when he was in America, after breakfast, he suddenly, on the breakfast table itself, he took out one envelope. He took out one envelope, that old envelope, and he cut it. So there was, second side was blank. On that, he started making a design of the emblem that will be registered for Ramakrishna Math. And that is why you find in all our publications, you will find an emblem of Ramakrishna Mission. That was designed by Swami Vivekananda. So he was a leader who gave, he was a visionary, not only visionary, a missionary. He started it and he gave the mandate. Shiva Gyana Jivse, worship the God in man. But not only that, he gave that emblem. He said the emblem should be such that is a registered emblem. Nobody else, no other organization can use this emblem. And he said emblem should be such that by that emblem, you get the whole philosophy of Ramakrishna Mission or of Swami Vivekananda. What is that emblem? You find that emblem, it must be somewhere in our publications. You might be getting, this is the emblem you are getting. You must have seen, there is a serpent, a coiled serpent, and there is a sun, and there is a waves of water, and there is a lotus, and there is a hansa. There is that swan. So what is the meaning? And it is written, Tanno Hansa Prachodayat. That serpent is the coiled energy of the Kundalini. That denotes Kundalini Shakti. That means Raj Yoga. What is Raj Yoga? That is arousing the Kundalini. Kundalini goes from the Muladhara to Sahasrara, and then you get Samadhi. So that is arousing the Kundalini. That is Raj Yoga. Lotus is Bhakti, love. That is Prem Yoga or path of Bhakti Yoga. Then sun, knowledge. Sun denotes Gyan Yoga. Waves of water are the waves of karma, karma yoga. And then swan is the Paramhans Paramatma, Tanno Hansa Prachodayat. This is how you achieve God realization. This is how you can reach Paramatman. How is that? By combination of four yogas. Raj Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Gyan Yoga, Karma Yoga. Each soul is potentially divine. The goal of human life is to manifest this divinity within by controlling nature external and internal. Do this either by work, worship, psychic control or philosophy, by one or more or all of these, and be free. This is the whole of religion. Dogmas, rituals, worships, temples, churches, mosques are but secondary details. This is the best way to develop SQ. You know, there is a book by Dana Zohar. She is a professor in Oxford University. SQ, Spiritual Intelligence, the Ultimate Intelligence, where she says neurologically, physiologically, biologically, psychologically, from every point of view, there is a concluding evidence. There is something called SQ, which is the basis of both IQ and EQ. What is IQ? IQ will tell you how to play the game of life. What is EQ? Emotional intelligence. Daniel Goleman made a research in 1991 and said EQ is more important than IQ. EQ will tell you how to play the game of life under changed circumstances with changed strategies. And what is SQ? SQ will tell you whether to play the game of life at all or not. Well, that is your choice. What is the meaning of life? What is the purpose of life? That will be told by SQ. And she has given various measures of developing SQ. But you will find that the Western models of SQ development are not working. But Swami Vivekananda gives a very comprehensive technique of developing this SQ. How? Combination of four yogas in daily life. Very easy. Just a little bit of meditation morning, evening. Little bit of prayer morning and evening. Little bit of inspiration morning and evening. And converting the work into worship, thinking that it is worship of the Lord. This is the fundamental way in which we can convert work into worship, in which we can practice this holistic management in our daily life by combination four yogas, develop IQ, EQ and SQ and get success in everyday life, and that will lead us to ultimate success. That is infinite joy, infinite happiness and infinite peace. Then only you can keep smiling. What President said, that keep smiling, but smile how it will come? When we practice these four yogas and there is peace inside, otherwise you are bubbling from within. Why my wife did not prepare this book for me, this particular dress for me? And you are bubbling from within. And what type of food she gave in the morning, this breakfast, what a wretched breakfast she had given to me. You are bubbling from within, to you are cursing your wife, your children, this and that. And you are full of tension. How can you smile? So smile will come when you have got this happiness from within. Peace from within, and that will come by practicing these four yogas. When you develop IQ, EQ and SQ, and then you get total success in everyday life, and you get eternal happiness, eternal peace and eternal life. So that is, and then Dana Zohar says, the one of the most important persons, the pioneers who practice this servant leadership in our own age is Swami Vivekananda. She also gives the name of Swami Vivekananda. So Swami Vivekananda had a very, very broad spectrum. He practiced servant leadership, what we are talking about. He advocated trusteeship management. Whatever we are talking about, the management values, he has practiced them. He has told about them. He was a global leader, which is very important for a global civilization. And he was a visionary and a missionary in one. And he was not an astrologer, but a visionary. Whatever he has told has come true. For example, he told, in 1897, India will become independent within 50 years. And exactly after 50 years, 1947, India became independent. He also said India will become independent in an informal way without waging a war. Nobody ever dreamt that a country could become independent without waging a war. Because Mahatma Gandhi came up only in 1915. Later on, he started a non-cooperation movement. But Swami Vivekananda visualized it. Swami Vivekananda, whatever he said, has come true. He also said in 1897 in his lecture in Chennai, India shall conquer the world by spiritual culture. That is yet to happen. It has already started happening. You know, there was a news item in Times of India. Americans going gaga over yoga. Americans going gaga over yoga. And the Time magazine brought out a special issue with the front cover showing Hollywood actors meditating. Inside cover story was Just Say Om, where it was sold. 10 million of Americans are having regular meditation. You cannot avoid meditation now in America. In churches, in mosques, in temples, of course. But even in hospitals, in prison houses, in schools, colleges, airports, railway platforms, everywhere you get meditation houses, meditation rooms. I went to United Nations building last year. I saw in a corner there's meditation room. When I went to Zurich, when I went to Europe for that second international conference on disaster management, so my return flight was from Zurich to Bombay. So there was some time, so I was strolling through the big market. They have prepared a very big market on Zurich airport. There was, I saw one board, signboard, meditation chamber, beautiful meditation chamber at Zurich airport. So, in a way, Swamiji's prophecy is coming true. Americans are now taking up this Indian spiritual culture. Only the paradox is that Indian youth are blindly imitating Western culture. That's a paradox. The other countries are now going for meditation and yoga, but our own youth are still going mad after the imitating the Western materialist culture. Well, Swami Vivekananda never said, be one-sided, no. Swami Vivekananda always said, be open-minded. He said, let us take the best of everything. What he wanted was Eastern and Western combined. He said, what we want is Western science coupled with Vedanta. Good things we must learn from other countries. He did not want to be one-sided, or he was not a closed mind. But he said, why do you want to blindly imitate the Western materialistic culture, which is giving rise to so many suicides, so many mental patients? Try to have, we have our own nectar of Indian spiritual culture. Of course, good things we must learn. And as far as modern science is concerned, just as Mr. Aikat had already told, when Swami Vivekananda was traveling from Japan to Chicago, in the same ship was Jamsetji Tata. And that time, Swami Vivekananda inspired Jamsetji Tata not to go for imports. He start our own industry so that we can employment to our own people. And he gave him inspiration to start Indian Institute of Science at Bangalore. This is when he was traveling in the same ship with Jamsetji Tata. Jamsetji Tata was going for that international fair that was going to happen, and Swamiji was going for participating in the World Parliament of Religions. But Swami Vivekananda was so broad-minded, so open-minded, and so modern even that he was far ahead of our time. That time he was talking about globalization. That time Swami Vivekananda was talking about this science and technology is a must if we want to develop. So science and Western science coupled with Vedanta, that is what Swami Vivekananda said. So he had a global perspective, and that is why Federico Mayer, the Director General of UNESCO, in 1993, when you know that centenary of Swami Vivekananda's participation in Chicago Parliament Regions was being observed, on October 8, 1893, there was a big celebration in Paris. At that time, Federico Mayer, the Director General of UNESCO, said, why we are celebrating Swamiji's participation in Parliament Religions? Why UNESCO is celebrating? He gave the reason. He said, when I went to the constitution of Ramakrishna Mission that was drawn up by Swami Vivekananda in 1897, I was surprised that that constitution was exactly similar to the constitution drawn up by UNESCO in 1947. He was so far ahead of his time. He was talking about harmony of religions. He was talking about serving the poor. He was talking about taking care of the underprivileged. In 1897, he was far ahead of our time. He said, that is why UNESCO is the proper place to celebrate Swami Vivekananda's participation in the Parliament. And now UNESCO is celebrating 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda. So Swami Vivekananda is very, very relevant today. I can go on, but I think the there is some question answers to be there. So at the end, I would like to only say that Swami Vivekananda was a multifaceted personality. So many aspects have been discovered by so many people, but it was reserved for Bharat Chamber of Commerce to focus on this particular aspect of Swami Vivekananda, that is management and leadership qualities. His innovation or his perspective about management, before the advent of management, he was talking about management. And before the advent of servant leadership, he was practicing servant leadership. This aspect of Swami Vivekananda's personality, of Swamiji's message, his global perspective, was not very well focused. And it's a very good beginning. And Bharat Chamber of Commerce has taken the initiative to unravel this type of personality, this aspect of Swami Vivekananda. That's a great thing. We need to do that so that Swamiji's message is relevant for everybody, for managers, executives, for the poor people, for the educationists, for the teachers, for the students. He messages for all. He loved all because he believed in Vedanta. For him, everybody was a manifestation of the same Brahman. There was a beautiful song, very favorite song of Swami Vivekananda. He was a great singer. And Sri Ramakrishna also was a great singer. So whenever Naren would come, Sri Ramakrishna, Naren, please sing. Naren, gao, ek to gao. And then Naren will sing. Then Naren said, now I'm going. No, not before you have sung that song. That is the favorite song of Sri Ramakrishna and also the favorite song of Swami Vivekananda. Which one is that song? That is the song written by the last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah Zafar. He was a Sufi saint, but the message of whole Vedanta goes there. Tujhse humne dil ko lagaya, jo kuch hai so tu hi hai, ek tujhko apna paya, जो कुछ ऐसे तो एवरीवेयर इज द सेम यूनिवर्सल कॉन्शियस प्रेजेंट. सबके मकान दिल का मकिन, तू कौन सा दिल है जिसमें नहीं तू, हर एक दिल में तू ही समाया, जो कुछ ऐसे तू ही है. एषा सर्वेषु भूतेषु गुणो आत्मा न प्रकाशते, दृश्यते त्वग्रया बुद्ध्या सूक्ष्मया सूक्ष्मदर्शिभिः. इनसाइड एवरी ह्यूमन बीइंग इज द सेम आत्मन. काबा में क्या, देवल में क्या, तेरी परवरिश होगी सबजा, सभी ने तुझको सिर है झुकाया, जो कुछ ऐसे तू ही है. Everywhere, Swami Sri Ramakrishna practiced all religions by turn. In his old laboratory and said, Jyoto mat tato path, as many faces, so many paths. Kya malayak, kya insan, kya hindu, kya musalman, jaisa chaha, tune banaya, jo kuch hai se tu hai. Tvam stri, tvam pumanasi, tvam kumar, utva kumari, tvam jino dande na vanchasi, tvam jato bhavashi vishwato mukha. Law, oh Lord, you are present in every person, young, old, you are torturing, you are the old man that is torturing with this inside every human being, you are the same. Same thing is being done. Arsh se lekar, farsh se zami tak, aur zami se arsh bari tak, jahan main dekha, tu hi nazar aya, jo kuch hai se tu hi hai. Sarvam khalu idam brahma, isha vasam idam sarvam. And last, socha, samja, dekha, bhala, tujh jaisa na koi dhund nikala, ab ye samaj mein zafar ki aya, jo kuch hai se tu hi hai. Everywhere is the same Lord present. Worship of the same Lord will give us. When you worship, it is a double profit. You know, when we are in Bharat Chamber of Commerce, we have to talk about profit. Swami Vivekananda talks about double profit. He says, double profit. 2% getting the profit. When you serve, when we go to the villages says, you have come here to serve. There's something, some selfishness must be there, some selfish interest is there, because government people also come to serve us, and we know how selfish they are. So you are also selfish people. You must have come with that selfish motive. Then I say, yes, 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 we have come with a selfish motive. Then they say, this Swami is at least good. At least he is talking the truth. He said, you are coming for selfish purpose. But then I said, but you ask me, what is the selfish purpose? We all have renounced the world. We have given up our parents, our children, our family members, everything. We have renounced everything. Why? We have sacrificed everything so that we can realize God in this very life. Atmano mokshartham. But Sri Ramakrishna said, worship of God in temple, churches, and mosques will give you, of course, God. But if you want to reach God quicker, the best way is to worship God in human beings. Worship the God in poor. So we have come here to serve you, not because of, not for serving you, but by because serving God in you, we will get our God relation quicker. That is the selfish purpose for we have come. They say that is a good purpose, good selfish purpose. So when we give some bread to a poor man, that poor man gets a bread and he gets his hungry appeased. That is a profit. You give to a sick person some medicine, his disease is removed. Yes, that's a profit to him. But what you get? He gets only chapati. What you get? salvation. What do you get? Infinite joy. What do you get? Infinite happiness. What do you get? He gets finite happiness. You get infinite happiness, infinite knowledge, infinite bliss, double profit. Double profit wala business ka business shuru kar diya Swami Vivekananda ne Ramakrishna Mission ke dwara. Double business profit. Double profit ka business. This is the profit. This is the double profit business. What is that? When you serve others with the idea that God is present in him or her, the other person of course gets benefited, but most benefit goes to you because you get infinite joy, infinite bliss, infinite happiness. So that is the message of Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda was a multifaceted personality. Let us bow down to him. And A.L. Basham, one of the greatest historians of our time, said, It is very difficult to evaluate the importance of Swami Vivekananda on the scale of history. He said in 1863, during the centenary of Swami Vivekananda, he said, it is very difficult to evaluate the importance of Swami Vivekananda on the scale of history because we are too near the history. Perhaps the future generations will be able to understand the importance better. We are very too near. And after 150 years also, I try to tell the same thing. We are too near the history to evaluate the importance of Swami Vivekananda. Perhaps the future generations will be able to do better justice. Thank you very much.